Prince Street is brought to you by Dean & DeLuca, purveyors of the finest food since 1977. With over 40 stores around the world, Dean & DeLuca curates the best ingredients for life.
"Well," said Pooh, "what I like best..." And then he had to stop and think. Because although eating honey was a very good thing to do, there was a moment just before you began to eat it, which was better than when you were. But he didn't know what it was called. Welcome to Prince Street.
I know what it's called. It's called desire. I'm Howie Kahn, and that's what we're talking about this month on Prince Street. Not only the romantic kind, but the longing for fulfillment, for pleasure, and for change. We talked to Isaac Mizrahi about his new cabaret act, and Christina Tosi about opening in Vegas and her secret to a great chocolate chip cookie. We found out why an Indian-American woman quit Goldman Sachs to follow her heart's desire. What we heard is that figuring out what you want is figuring out who you are. I think their answers will surprise you. All that and more, including essential wine tips from Jay McInerney, Paul Grieco, and Bianca Bosker. We've got a great show. Don't go away. Since breaking onto the fashion scene in 1986, Isaac Mizrahi's designs have been sold everywhere. From Bergdorf's to Target, where his sales reached as much as $300 million a year. Mizrahi is the subject of the award-winning documentary Unzipped. And this month, he's expressing another love, cabaret. Prince Street correspondent Alex Guarnaschelli caught up with a friend the night after he opened at the renowned Café Carlyle in Manhattan. His act is called Does This Song Make Me Look Fat?
How's everything going?
Everything is going really good, I think. I mean, last night was big night. It opened here and, you know, I'm not one of those people who goes like, wow, right? I go like, what went wrong? I only see flaws.
And what does that leave you with when you see only the flaw?
The thing is that getting to a critical age, you understand how pointless this pursuit of perfection is. And like, you deal with food, right? You deal with like a roast, right? Every single roast is different. And to think you're going to make a perfect roast is a ridiculous thought, right? Because it's impossible. So you can't look for perfection. It's beside the point. And I'll go further. Since my dog Harry left the earth in May, which was the hardest day of my life, I've decided that like there is no point to even think. I've become very nihilistic and very fatalistic. And I think like perfection, what? Like how about pleasure? How about pleasure, darling? Pleasure. Instead of perfection, I think pleasure now. You know, I'm trying to find pleasure. I'm talking about pleasure from ice cream, pleasure from sex or something. I mean it. It's like the idea of pleasure is a big one on my mind.
I think you reach a certain age. I said to my dad a couple of years ago, I don't think I understand what the point of life is. And he said, right, just live it. That's the point of it, living it. Mm-hmm. And I thought, that's so fleeting. I mean, one day just dissipates, and what do you have to show for it? Did you make a sweater? Oh. Did you make a roast?
Well, that's what I'm trying to get away from, darling, is that. That's in me so deeply. That's in my physical
DNA.
Being, my DNA. And it's in yours, too, right?
That's why I love you.
Yeah. Yeah.
We have that same need, that burning desire to produce.
And we have to get over it, I think. The balance between sort of accomplishment, which is what we used to think was everything about life. Let's go to ambition, accomplishment, drive, going, working, which working is different than accomplishing, right? But, and then you get here and you go like, wait a second, whoa, maybe accomplishment is bullshit. Maybe it's like about sort of drinking more. Like, I need to drink more. I swear. I need to, like, take more drugs or something. I mean that, Alex.
I'm with you on that. Okay. And you love food in your way. You write me, I just finished jarring my tomato sauce.
That's right. Oh, you need a jar of my tomato sauce.
I have yet to sample such
it's
said
It's based
goods.
On your recipe. You know that, right? Based on your recipe.
And how much do I love based?
Well,
on my
I changed
recipe.
It to. I mean, like, I can probably publish it as my own because I've changed it so much that. Call my lawyer, okay? That's all I'm saying.
I've already have
call
an email
my
in
lawyer.
To your lawyer. And mine
no,
as well.
But here's the great thing about the sauce is that there's no onions in it, just shallots. I mean, that is a very elegant difference, right?
It really is.
I'm telling you. And the use, I don't know if this was your idea or my idea. I can't remember. There are some yellow tomatoes in it. Was that your idea or my idea?
The yellow is mine.
Okay.
You probably added in some red and orange because...
Bitch. Oh, sorry. No, because it comes out this color. It's almost like you almost think you're having ale vodka or something. No. You know what I mean by like cream sauce when it comes that pink color?
And there's no dairy in it.
There's no dairy in it. And it's divine. And it's got a little bit of vinegar in it, just a little. And not a lot of sugar, like a teaspoon of sugar in a whole sort of batch.
Right.
And it's so good because there's nothing to counterbalance. There's not the whole onion thing, right? Seriously.
Well, you remember in Goodfellas when he says don't put too many onions in the sauce.
Yes.
No one forgets that. I mean, when you say, tell me about the movie Goodfellas, they reference the garlic being sliced
true.
With a razor blade.
Yep.
And then don't put too many onions in the sauce. And so, yeah, I think shallots are sweeter. And so you need
all the
less
difference,
sugar.
Darling. All the difference.
And the crushed
all
red
the
pepper flakes and the rice wine vinegar. It's actually,
all the difference.
It's actually really a hot tomato vinaigrette masquerading as tomato sauce.
It's true. Unless you reduce it down, which I do. I reduce it so it becomes...
Oh, you do, do
yeah,
you?
Yeah, a little bit.
This
I do.
This is going on my notes for the
See
lawyer.
What I'm saying?
So you make
funny.
A big batch.
I make batches and batches. I make like 70 jars.
Here we go again with the productivity.
Crazy. I know.
Can
it's a crazy thing.
Can you make just one jar?
And people go... No, people go, oh, is that fun? And I go, well, fun's a big word. You know, like, is blanching thousands of... Like, literally 100 pounds of tomatoes. Is that fun? But then I go to the farmer's market. You know the one. Right?
Pikes.
Yeah. I go there and I see those tomatoes and I'm like, oh my God,
they're
what
so
beautiful
good.
Produce. I must make tomatoes. And by the way, they're not plum tomatoes, they're tomatoes. And that's another thing that makes it taste a little, like you said, fresher than, because you know, those plum tomatoes make a part, you can't go wrong with those.
True. I go to a green market, I see herbs and tomatoes and melons and I get in, my heart palpitates. So I can understand, as a chef, I love the tactile experience of cooking. So the first time I met you, I thought he must enjoy the tactile experience of fabric and sewing and all of that. It must be the same as making a great roast, making
yes.
a great shirt.
But listen, can you divorce like the eating of the roast from the making of the roast?
They don't at all coincide for me.
Okay. So you can make a roast, and if it comes out terrible, you don't care as long as you have the pleasure of making it?
No matter what I cook, I never want to eat it.
Wow.
The minute it's been cooked by me.
Call me, because I'll eat it.
Occasionally now. After cooking for all these years, I can make something and look at it. I'll make 20 things.
Yeah.
I'll cook 20 different dishes and I'll see one. I'll lay it all out.
Right.
And I'll say, I'll have a bite of that.
Right.
And it moderately might not disgust me. And by the way, I don't want to get into self-loathing because it's so boring.
Oh, God. Okay.
I just want to say that maybe sometimes, just like a song has to come out of you no matter what the price internally is. And I see your mixture of confidence and artistry mixed with, I don't know if you want to run off the stage and hide under it. I see that balance you're always striking. So it's sort of the same for me with food. Tell me about the cabaret.
You know, it's something I've been doing for quite a long time. I've been doing it since, I don't know, like the 20th century at least. And it just happened. I don't exactly know. You know, when I was a little tiny kid, I was a female impersonator when I was like 8 years old. I used to do like Streisand, right? In like 1970.
Okay.
And it wasn't exactly the best accepted part of my personality, this sort of tangent that I used to go on doing Streisand or Liza or Judy Garland or something, right? But I did it. Something impelled me. Something like made me go and find people to watch me do this. And I think that's got a lot to do with it. It just started from out of nowhere. And so now, instead of doing impersonations, I actually just stand on the stage and sing songs and tell stories.
Did you dress up?
I did not dress up. No,
at
it was
all.
Never a drag thing. No, it was just the voice, which sounded exactly like the person. It really did. and also the mannerisms. I did the mannerisms, but I never did the drag. I mean, I might have. It wasn't like I said, oh, no. You know, I have to say...
Was that too far? Would that have been going too far?
No, it was just because I don't think of myself as such a good-looking specimen. So, like, then put makeup on it and then, like, whoa. You know, it's like, then it's just not going to look too good, right? It's going to make a mockery or something of the subject, right? And I didn't mean to be mocking the subject. I meant to be, like, sort of, what, glorifying the subject, you know? I just don't look very pretty in drag, I don't think. I mean, when I was a tiny kid, I tried on my mom's makeup here and there, just to see what it felt like, because I was obsessed. And I used to watch her makeup.
Your mom put on a lot of makeup?
No, but I watched her. She put on
the rituals.
Yes, the rituals of the lashes and the eyeliner, etc. And I was fascinated by it. And so I thought, oh, I'm going to try it on me. And it just didn't look too good. So yeah.
You let that part go.
I let the part of putting on drag go, yes.
And so now you just wear, you almost neutralize and you wear a uniform when you do this.
Pretty much. I dress that way in general, you know? I feel like I have lots of fancy clothes. I just don't wear them. You know, I just never wear them.
I think that's the same as me not eating what I cook.
Maybe. It could be. I do remember once in, like, I'm not kidding you, like the early 2000s, when I actually felt thin enough in this gorgeous suit, which finally fit me in this incredible perfect grade of wool that wasn't like one of those annoying, like, lightweight wools. It was a beautiful, beautiful woolen thing. And it fit me like you couldn't believe it. It was made on Savile Row, you know, Anderson and Shepherd. This thing was it. And I had millions of suits from Savile Row, and none of them fit me. This one just decided it was going to fit because it was crazy.
I like how the suit decided to fit you.
Oh, no. The shoes were John Loeb. They were made by hand. Couture fittings and everything. It took 6 years to make these shoes, right? They were like $7,000 just for some beautiful leather shoes in those days. The socks were like from this one factory in Italy that made these little socks.
They better have been hand woven.
I'm serious.
Isaac,
my hair was good. Everything was good. I was like, just my hair was, everything was good, right? And I said, is this what this is what it's like to feel like good? And it never happened again. How's that? Never happened. It happened once when I actually thought, well, you look great.
You remember every delicious second.
I do, yeah.
Okay.
No, wait a minute. Okay, can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
Because you did stand-up, didn't you?
I still do stand-up.
Where?
You think I'm going to tell you? Then you'll come.
Well, you're not coming to this show, are you? Seriously. You cannot. She cannot
do
come.
Do not
to
worry.
Show.
I would not come to this show for a
good.
Million
All right.
years.
You cannot come.
See you tomorrow night.
No.
Are you going to sing?
I'll sing, yeah. Is Ben gonna play? I have a feeling that beneath the little halo on your noble head, there lies a thought or two the devil might be interested to know. You're like the finish of a novel that I finally have to take to bed. You fascinate me so. I feel like Christopher Columbus when I'm near enough to contemplate the sweet geography descending from your eyebrow to your toe. The possibilities are more than I could possibly enumerate. That's why you fascinate me so. So sermonize and preach to me. Make your sanctimonious little speech to me. But underneath it all, I think that you are really just a reprobate. And you're afraid of what'll happen if you ever let it show. You may scold me and berate me, but I love to make you hate me. You fascinate me so. So sermonize and preach to me. Make your sanctimonious little speech to me. But oh my darling, you'll forgive my inability to concentrate. I feel I'm dealing with a powder keg that's just about to blow. Will the end result deflate me, or will you annihilate me, you? Aggravate me, you. Irritate me, you. Fascinate me so. Those are good words. words, right? Blossom Deary. It's good. All right. Just...
You can catch Isaac at Café Carlyle through February 11th. And to find his upcoming shows, check out his website, isaacmizrahi.com. When photographer and author Melanie Dunay recently returned from an ashram in India, talking about managing her doshas, I knew she'd be the ideal reporter to explore the world of Ayurvedic chocolate. A journey that takes her now to its spiritual home, Inglewood, New Jersey.
So before every production, we meditate.
That's Alak Vasa, founder of Elements Truffles.
We do a short Thanksgiving prayer before we start our production, saying, you know, we have prepared everything, we are ready, and now, universe, it's up to you how you want this batch to move forward. And alongside, as we are making these chocolates, we have this Sanskrit chants playing in the background. And these chants are so powerful because they are actually impacting the subtle energy in the room and also the state of your mind.
So, Alak, how does somebody go from working at Goldman Sachs to start making chocolates?
Well, I started my journey in the U.S., coming to school, did my master's in computer science, and the next progressive thing in my head was, okay, I have to look for a job and really be successful here. And before I realized, I was already working for 12 years of my life. About mid-career, I learned how to meditate. And suddenly I started realizing that, you know, my right brain was never activated. After meditating now, there was this inner voice that started talking to me, saying, you're meant to do something else. You're meant to do something else. And for many years, I kind of just kept it in the background, saying, okay, you know, everybody goes through that. You do something for too long, and the boredom kicks in maybe, and then you think it's an inner voice, but it's nothing but, you know, looking out for change. And there came a point in my career where I decided, you know what, enough of this, and I'm quitting my job. And when I quit my job, I really didn't know what I was going to do next. I could have either gone and looked for another job in finance, or this was my time to take this plunge and follow my inner calling.
So was the inner voice your sweet tooth?
It was, yes, absolutely. I am a sweet tooth.
So I heard not only were you working in an investment bank, but you also had an internship?
So I was working at Goldman, and I used to go to this patisserie all the time. The staff and the chef and everyone knew me. And at some point, this thought came to my mind, you know, I want to go to culinary school. So I thought, why not I ask the chef at this patisserie what's a good school to go to? And to my surprise, he said, come work for me. And I was shocked and elated at the same time. And the next sentence he said is, see you on Saturday at 6 a.m. And not only him, but I was surprised that I was there every Saturday at 6 a.m. for the next 6 months of my life.
But, you know, there's a difference between having an idea of, oh, I want to go into chocolate or making chocolate or listen to my inner voice and doing it. So how did you even know where to start?
I realized that there were a few elements that I wanted to have in whatever I created. The first thing was history, an intention, some element of creativity, and a sense of purpose. And when I started looking at history, and I definitely knew I wanted to do something in food, so that was not a question. But then when I started looking at history and, you know, what has been the foundation for me growing up, what has created my food palette, what kept on coming up was Ayurveda.
So Ayurveda is Sanskrit for the knowledge of life or daily living, and practicing Ayurveda is about harmonizing and balancing the mind, body, and environment.
Ayurveda has been such an integral part of our life growing up, you know, and I thought, you know, why not integrate this amazing science, which is so focused on a holistic lifestyle, and integrate it with chocolate, where chocolate is viewed as something sinful indulgence or guilty pleasure, and make it a fun, indulgence that you can truly enjoy from time to time. As long as it's not, you know, sweetened with refined sugar, there's no dairy in it, there's no vegetable oils and soy lecithin.
So what's the difference between raw and commercial chocolate?
So raw chocolate is chocolate that during the entire stage of its preparation doesn't go above 118 degrees Fahrenheit. Raw cacao, like in its unprocessed form, is so rich in so many nutrients and antioxidants and other things, which are preserved when you don't cook it above 118 degrees Fahrenheit. So that's the primary difference between raw and not raw chocolates.
So what makes this chocolate Ayurvedic?
I would say two things. One is the sweetener, which is honey, and the Ayurvedic herbs that we infuse in the chocolates, which is turmeric, cardamom, and other things. And one more thing that I would also like to add is that because we don't add any dairy or any preservatives, that is also in line with the philosophy of Ayurveda.
The intent of the chocolate, I understand. Tell me more about the process, the actual making of the chocolate.
The first thing that we do with our chocolate is using honey as a sweetener, which in itself is a challenge. You won't see many chocolates out there that are sweetened with honey. And
why?
Because honey has moisture, and chocolate and moisture don't go well together. So if you were to make a bean to bar and you take the chocolate paste and try to mix it with honey, it'll become a big goo.
Mm.
But there is a trick to it that when you just emulsify the honey in the fat portion of the cacao, which is the cacao butter, it emulsifies beautifully, and then you add on to the cacao powder, and voila, you have a beautiful chocolate that tastes good, that melts in my mouth, and then depending on the flavor, we infuse it with the pure essential oil for that flavor. For example, if I'm making the peppermint lavender bar, then there is, you know, a hint of peppermint oil and lavender oil. And that's all that we add to our chocolates. We don't add any emulsifiers or artificial preservatives just to extend the shelf life of our chocolates. So currently our chocolate's shelf life is 6 months, and we're happy with that. We know we might run into problems when you go for distribution in big stores because they expect chocolate's life they expect the chocolate to have a shelf life of about a year and a half. But that is not something we want to compromise on just because, you know, that's what's done in the past.
So you have raspberry, peppermint, orange pistachio, and rose. What's the next flavor?
So we're working something for Valentine's, and we wanted to create a spicy flavor, something with, like, pink peppercorn and lemon, lemongrass, something. Some of these flavors are kind of twirling in my head, so we'll see.
Ooh, ooh la la.
Yeah.
So I noticed that you, on your bars, it says that you give 25% of your profits to the education of underprivileged children.
As, you know, I decided to start this journey, one thing I told myself is I do not want this to become another corporate Wall Street type of experience where it's always in the head. I wanted to keep that right balance of the head and the heart, and I feel donating this 25% to the education of children really, you know, gives that sense of purpose and brings me back to the heart instead of always staying in the head. Am I making enough? Am I creating enough? Is this a good business to be in? It's more, no, it's such a beautiful journey that we've embarked upon. And the support that we've received from unexpected places is just, you know, what makes this whole experience so magical.
To learn more about Alak and Elements Chocolates, go to elementstruffles.com. Coming up, wine tips and chocolate chip cookies. Don't go away. This month on Eden Eats NYC, Eden visits Marco Canora at Brodo in the East Village. They talk about what it means for a chef to change his life, and maybe yours too. How? With bone broth.
Why don't you tell everyone, what is bone broth?
The million-dollar question. There's so much. There's so much debate out there about what is bone broth, and people are like, oh, you know, it's not, just call it stock because that's what it is. And then other people are like, isn't it just broth? And some people want to just call it soup. And, you know, I will admit there's a lot of confusion out there. There are a lot of different points of view. You know, in my mind, stock is a very old school French thing because you make it with bones, which has a lot of collagen, and then the resulting liquid that comes from cooking bones and water is something that has a lot of gelatin in it, and you reduce that gelatin, and it becomes viscosity-like for sauces, and the French repertoire is built around sauce making. Mm-hmm. So it's stock, lots of gelatin, a lot of knuckles, cartilage, veal stock, and you end up with a very gelatinized
rich
liquid that you reduce down to a demi-glace, which is reduced by half, mm-hmm, and then it's really thick, so you could start with the whole repertoire of sauce making in the French world of cooking. Mm-hmm. And broth, to me, is more of the Italian approach, where it's not about joints and bones, it's more about meat. So the classic brodo that we use has a lot of like whole stewing hens and turkey drumsticks, where there's a lot of meat, so there's a little bit less of the gelatin piece. So that's one distinguishing factor that's been around forever, I think, is that stock is more bone and broth is more meat. But then now it's confusing. If broth is meat and stock is bone, and you put bone and broth together, now you have a confluence of both.
Yeah.
And the other distinguishing factor between bone broth, or what defines bone broth in my mind, is the cook time. So bone broth is typically cooked, you know, at least 12 hours. Some people say they cook it 48 hours. We cook ours for 18 hours. But it's this idea of extracting as many nutrients and as much as the collagen out of the bones as you can.
How did you get the desire to drink bone broth, to drink mm-hmm brodo?
You know, I'll say a couple things about that. You know, one is I grew up in an Italian household and my mother was a huge cook. And, you know, having broth at our holiday meals and making a pot of broth when my sister or I got sick. And then as a professional chef, you know, broth is kind of like salt and pepper. And, you know, how I took the broth to the next step of the brodo window, you know, has a lot to do kind of with my own health. So being a chef for 20 years, you know, drinking a lot of booze and smoking a lot of cigarettes and eating a lot of sugar got me to a point where I was pretty unhealthy.
And the chef lifestyle especially is like, it can be...
It's brutal.
Really, really aggressive.
Yeah, without question. Uh-huh. And it, you know, it paid its toll on me, and I hit 40 and I wasn't feeling really good about anything. Overweight, kind of, you know, very short fuse. I wasn't able to manage people the way I wanted to manage people. And there was always a big pot of hearth broth on the stove. I made a conscious effort to like just start sipping it as a practice throughout my day to kind of keep me away from bread and butter and another cigarette. And it really helped. And, you know, I don't believe in magic bullets, but it was a big piece of it for me. And the vast majority of the health benefits of broth comes from the existence of collagen. It's literally the glue that holds our body together. Mm-hmm. So, you
know, I'm so vain. I'm like, it's what keeps my skin nice and elastic, right?
But it's also it's also internally, yeah, too. So it also helps the lining of your gut stay whole. You know, inflammation is born from the gut, and I think a vast majority of disease is born from inflammation. So if you kind of connect the dots, like healing your gut has the ability to heal a lot that ails you. And broth is a great practice to heal your gut.
And it's so good for you that you're actually now serving it on the maternity floor for women that are in labor.
Yeah, so we partnered with NYU Langone, and they did a little pilot program where we push a little brodo cart around the maternity ward for expecting mothers and new mothers.
Oh, don't tell me that, because I'm pregnant. I'm giving birth in this hospital.
Well, so you're going to get some brodo.
I'm thrilled for the brodo, but the good food, I'm like... So why don't you tell me a little bit about the process of making your brodo?
There's two pieces. There's the base broths, and then there's all the add-ins. And the idea is that, you know, you pick your base broth, and then you choose from 21 different add-ins to compose your beverage. Things like the deeply rooted, which is hearth broth with turmeric and ginger, or the tom yum, which is chicken broth with coconut milk, chili oil, and a curry spice and a squeeze of lime.
So what are the plans? Where do you want to go with this?
One of the things is the whole hospital thing that we talked about, because I think it's really exciting to have an impact and just to educate people and make them understand that this is really a great beverage and to think differently about broth.
And do you see yourself traveling to new cities with this? Like, do you?
I mean, listen, I have a few big fantasy things.
Yeah.
One of them is to be at the Winter Olympics, because I think that this is the perfect thing to sip on while you're watching ski jumping or something. And then the other one is to take it, like, I hope that there's a day where I could say Brodo is in Tokyo and London, maybe Milan, or maybe Copenhagen or Berlin, or...
Go big. Go big with it. Take it around the world.
We'll see.
Excellent. Well, I am excited to get in the kitchen with you. I can't wait to see you prepare this bone broth, and I can't wait to taste all of them. And to watch Marco and I make his famous Brodo, head to livefromprincestreet.com.
When you think of teenage desire, you probably don't think of sweating onions or food handling certificates. Next up, Prince Street correspondent Rose Reed goes back to high school to meet a group of aspiring chefs.
My name is Kyle Brown, and I'm a junior at Food and Finance High School.
Kyle, you want to tell me what you're doing?
I am sweating onions right now. That's the stage before it caramelizes.
I'm at Food and Finance High School in Hell's Kitchen, which is New York's only culinary high school. It opened in 2004. Today, more than 85% of Food and Finance seniors graduate. In most New York City high schools, the average is only 70%. When you walk through the halls, it feels like any other urban high school. And there are the familiar fluorescent lights and lockers and beat-up school desks, 389 teenagers. They're loud and they're rowdy. That is, until they enter the kitchen classroom.
Kyle wants to be Iron Chef one day. Right, Kyle?
Of course. One day I will.
One day you will. Or Master Chef.
We're in an industrial kitchen about the size of a basketball court. The front of the room is flanked with enormous convection ovens. There are chrome counters on either side of the stoves, and kitchen sinks line the wall in the back. 20 students wearing white chef coats and chef hats stand in silent attention as their teacher, Chef Jeffrey Tulloch, stops class to review the next food course that the students are going to make.
Our horchetti with some garlic slice. Don't mince.
Freshman year, they start learning the very basics. Before even touching the knife, they learn things like sanitation. Sophomore year, it now introduces them to cooking. By the time they get to junior year, It's really all about the service, because now you're getting them ready for the service industry, whether they go off to work or they go to college.
So multitask, guys, multitask.
So Kyle, being at Food and Finance, has that affected how you cook with your family?
Now I know like the proper way to do things, and like I correct my mother in a way. She doesn't like that at all. For example, like ribs. My mom's usually, she'll leave it there on the stove for so long, waiting for it to cook. But like, you don't have to do that, because like then it will take away the moisture and the texture.
So what did she say to you when you were like, Mom, you're going to overcook it?
She said, just because you're going to Food and Finance doesn't mean you know everything. My mom, she doesn't like to be corrected.
80% of the children at Food and Finance High School, and they come from all five boroughs in New York City, live below the poverty level.
That's Nan Shipley. She's the chair of the board of directors for the school.
We also have a significant population of undocumented students and first-generation Americans. Students are completely transformed by the time they leave our school, really had a new chance at life.
My mom, my grandma pushed me to maybe become like a lawyer or a doctor. I didn't want to do that. I'm not cut out for that kind of stuff.
And then that's Jessica Ng. She's a senior at Food and Finance, and she does a four-hour commute every day to attend this high school.
I start my day off in Bayside, Queens, where I live. Usually I have to walk to the bus to Flushing Main Street, where I take the 7 train to...
Like most food and finance students, to graduate, she must complete general coursework in math and science, English history, as well as culinary classes covering sanitation, knife skills, sauces, pastry. And then there's the 250 hours of paid work experience. For Jessica, that's a pastry job at one of New York's most famous bakeries or washers on the Upper East Side.
Workplace, I kind of like dread it when I'm starting to like get dressed and put my stuff down and everything. But as I get up there and as I start to actually make something and actually handle food. When you're mixing the dough, you lift up the mixer and you touch it to see how it is, because usually with pastry, you're never going to know if like a piece of dough is done mixing unless you touch it with your own hands.
Jessica, the minute she came in freshman year, I knew this young lady was exceptional. She had photos of her own cake, of dishes that she made, and it was impressive. I'm like, wow. To see her grow into the young lady that she is today, it puts you as the educator in a position where you know what you're doing is paying off.
So tell me how you found the school. Did you come here with ambitions to cook? Was that one, did you know about that?
Well, funny story. I think I was in the seventh grade, but one day I saw on YouTube this video, and it was called Microwave Cake in a Mug. Idea.
You bake the cake in the microwave, so it's super easy, and you make
simple ingredients, your eggs, your flour, your leavening agents, and after that, it turned out really horrible. I didn't know what to do. I just had to spit it out after I bit it. But ever since then, I fell in love with pastry.
Like most New York City public schools, Food and Finance uses a lottery system to select its students. About 26 students apply for every one seat. Jessica was lucky. Now, as she applies to culinary colleges and competes for scholarship money, she has to be one of the best, too.
I think inspires them to work hard is competition. Kids love competition. Everyone loves competition.
Basically, my life is being consumed by training for this competition.
If Jessica wins this competition, she'll be awarded a scholarship from one of the culinary colleges that sponsors the contest. If she loses, she may not be able to go. Tuition at the Culinary Institute of America, for example, is $28,000 a year.
It's time. It's testing out our technical skills, like knife skills. We have to make two constructed salads with basic knife cuts in 50 minutes. Bell pepper cucumber salad and two French rolled omelets in 15 minutes. And it's supposed to be like no wrinkles and bubbles and stuff. And it's going to probably take like 3 hours, four maybe. We wait till everyone is done and then they make a little speech and we go home. And then we wait, which is the worst time, the waiting. Just going to wait for that email.
Our advisory board of probably the top 50 chefs in New York City, people are dying to have our kids. They're skilled, they're committed, and the hospitality industry is growing by 20% in New York City alone. Statistic is 20% by 2020. And there aren't enough chefs, there aren't enough line cooks, there aren't enough prep cooks to fill all of those positions. So our advisory board and New York City as a whole is looking to places like our school to fill that need.
I think what really keeps me going is just the food itself.
Now I know that I want to open my own restaurant, like probably put a restaurant in a hotel, and I want to open my own hotel. I want to open a couple of chains of restaurants, and then as I grow, more ideas might come. So.
A lot of people actually do lose the desire to pursue it because it's too hard, it's long hours, nothing is handed to you on the silver platter. So I think that I really have to work for it, and that's what keeps me motivated. I do hope that all my work in school, my cooking competition, and my internship at the bakery, like making 100 pounds of brioche, will pay off. I keep reminding myself that it's going to be worth it.
Whatever happens next for Jessica Ng and Kyle Brown, the cooking skills that they've learned at Food and Finance have made them more confident, employable, and fun to have around.
I like to, you know, surprise my family. I'll make homemade latkes that's like hash browns. Like, you know, just switch it up. Something that my parents never had before. So like when it comes out good, like my mom, she doesn't like to admit that what I did was good. Like she'll just taste and then she won't say a word. Like I know it's good after that.
To find out more about Food and Finance High School and their fundraising and scholarship programs, go to their website, foodfinancehs.org. Our next guest started working for David Chang in 2006. 11 years later, she runs her own dessert empire, Milk Bar, with 10 locations across North America. She's published 2 books and co-hosts MasterChef and MasterChef Junior on Fox. Prince Street correspondent Sierra Tishgart visited Christina Tosi at her Williamsburg headquarters. It was just days after she opened Milk Bar's newest outpost at the Cosmopolitan of Las Vegas.
I want to talk about both professional desire, romantic desire. I'm wondering, to start, you had this avant-garde training, yes, as a pastry chef, WD-50, yeah, but really tapped into this desire for nostalgia.
Yes.
What inspires that and drives that?
It's a good question. I got into baking. I got into food in general because I loved spending time with the women in my family growing up. So I have a very emotional connection to food and eating and baking from like a nurturing perspective. I decided to become a formal like pastry chef, went, got formal training, and like actually put myself on a very like French route for dessert. And I loved the things that it brought, but never felt connected to the food that I was making.
I studied applied mathematics in the Italian language, and the thought of being a grown-up, the thought of having a routine in my life that felt inescapable concerned me greatly. And I tasked myself with the simple question of, okay, like, tell me what the one thing that you could do every single day without ever getting sick of it is. And for me, it was really simple and was making cookies, which is like crazy. My mom's like, you're an applied math major. You can do something more than make cookies, you know? Like, you can do that when you get home at night. And for me, it was like, no, that is the thing that I could do day in and day out and never get sick of.
The dessert that you feel like made your career. Can you tell me about that process? Because it really changes your life.
I think I have 2 desserts that made my career. We were opening Momofuku Ko, which is the sort of fancy, the most high-end tasting menu-only restaurant of the Momofuku Empire in the East Village. It was tasting menu-only. People don't get to choose what dessert they have. You have to basically read people and go, all right, I'm going to force feed someone dessert. What's it going to be? And I want it to be the best course that they have. And so I made 2 desserts. One was a deep fried apple pie.
Oh, yes.
With miso butterscotch and sour ice cream. I think that was a very big making of my career in the way of it really represented me through food in the way that it was like humble and gettable and simple, but still exotic enough and new and refined, where it really played to both like my home baking days and my like yearning and discerning desire to eat dessert every day, the deep down delicious dessert. The other dessert was a cereal milk panna cotta. It was the first time I ever played around with cereal milk. I wanted to make a panna cotta just in case the fryer wasn't working or what have you, and I wanted to make it an interesting flavor. And I was just trying to think about, like, all right, what can I flavor the milk in this panna cotta, which is the base of the dessert? What would be an interesting flavor to it? And I kind of, after many months, like, ended up kind of standing on my head in the aisle of a bodega late at night, and I was like, well, cereal and milk make cereal milk, and there's a good idea or a bad idea. And it ended up being an idea that really resonated with people. And so, and again, I think that captured the spirit of, like, simple, curious, clever, something you get and that you connect with, but that's still a surprise and is still a really fun reach.
Is that the first cereal milk dessert?
First cereal milk dessert.
I didn't know that.
I opened Milk Bar probably 8 months later.
I didn't know that that was the origin of cereal, the cereal milk.
I like, no one asks, you know?
How does desire play into MasterChef? Do you ever feel like you obviously develop relationships with the contestants. Does it ever get in the way when you're like, oh, I really, really like this person?
That's a really good question.
It must be hard to stay totally objective in that sense.
Well, staying objective is really easy when it comes to food. So the thing that you have to remember is, even though you're mentoring these home cooks, whether they're adult home cooks or they're young home cooks, is the knowing how much potential someone has. And when they don't deliver on a given challenge, that part's tricky because you desire to see them succeed and you desire to see them tap into their full potential. And it is a balancing act. And it's just an emotional roller coaster for us as judges.
Oh, totally. You know, you got married this year.
Yes.
Congratulations again.
Thank you.
How has it been as you're juggling, as you're flying back and forth between MasterChef? I mean, owning a food concept and being in a relationship is hard enough.
It's really funny. I don't ever think about it as being difficult. I think about it really only in the way that it's additive, because it's a commitment, but it's not a commitment that feels like it comes with any great effort. I would probably stay to work until 10 or 11 p.m. every night, and it's awesome to have a reason to be like, I gotta get the heck out of here. Like, I have something else amazing waiting just outside these doors. It's not fun to say goodbye, but it's fun to miss each other.
Yes.
And it's so much fun when then you finally see each other, because it makes every moment that you do get to spend with each other an adventure.
Do you have any specific dessert romantic memories that stand out from over the years?
I remember one of my high school boyfriends worked at an ice cream store, which you would be like, that home run, dude. Like, that's exactly where you need to be working. And I have historically loved cookies my entire life. And he would bring me home. It was one of those ice cream stores where you chose your mix-ins and then on a marble, they mixed it all together. Because if I would go to the ice cream store, I'd get, like, order the ice cream, but basically wait for it all to melt to eat the cookie dough bits out.
Yeah, best
and
part.
He would bring me pints of basically only cookie dough bits. Oh, I feel like that's an important romantic gesture.
I'm like you. Like, there's, like, something so just, I want to say romantic, but even if it's just me, so special and comforting about desserts, but especially when you're sharing it with someone you love.
I think desserts have a good rap, but I think sometimes desserts have a bad rap, right? And desire kind of plays into that, like,
forbidden,
I want something
nature.
Forbidden. Yeah, the forbidden fruit. Like, I know I'm not really supposed to have it every day, but I still want it every day. And there is something like the secret of, like, looking forward to the moments where you get to have dessert, and the lead up to it is important. But I think for me, when I think about, like, the theme of desire and dessert professionally, it's also making sure you deliver on that. It has to be the most delicious bite.
Did you feel like, you know, for each place you tweak what you offer and the different pastries, did you feel like what you did in Vegas and what you actually created in terms of food had to be somehow more over the top? How did you jive with that energy there?
I think the things that we knew were that we could get away with more in Vegas. Like, the desire level in Vegas is different than, like, the everyday desire level at, like, Milk Bar Carroll Gardens, right?
Yes.
Like, you're going to Vegas and you're like, I'm not going to feel bad about a single thing.
That's very,
that
I'm or it's
to
not going to be eating a cookie.
Yeah. We launched fancy shakes, which are, like, basically boozy milkshakes, but of course we do them on our terms. Like, you can get a cereal milk white Russian or a nutcracker, which is like a crack pie milkshake with frangelico in it. So it's a little nutty and it's crack. Get it, nutcracker.
Yeah.
And we launched Milks, which is basically our version of a McFlurry or a Blizzard through the Milk Bar lens.
I know you love Dairy Queen too.
Yeah.
That was your
childhood. Dairy Queen is like my childhood. Like, every Thursday my dad would bring us to Dairy Queen and it was like the highlight of our week.
What do you have coming up in terms of new baked goods? What's in development?
We just launched or relaunched our grapefruit pie in Washington, D.C., which is like a Ritz cracker crunch.
I've never had that.
Oh, you would love it. It's a Ritz cracker crunch, so immediately you're like, keep talking. Salty, sweet, buttery, delicious. Grapefruit curd, some grapefruit threads that run through, which is great. That just came on the menu actually today in D.C.
Any signature trick for baking cookies?
Great cookies start with great butter. Unsalted European style butter is the butter that we use. That's just like 101. You can use your same old, you know, cookie recipe. Do that. You'll be a pro. When you go to cream your butter and your sugars, when you add your egg, cream them for longer than you think. It's not like a quick mix. We cream ours for 10 minutes. It's called the 10-minute creaming process, just to give you an example of, like, it's probably the most underestimated tip. That's given. When you add your dry ingredients, alternatively, mix it for as little as possible. The second you add flour to cookie dough, you start the gluten forming process. And gluten is great when you're mixing bread, but unless you want your cookie to be like bready and rock hard, mix it for as little as possible, and you will get a beautiful, tender cookie. If you're making chocolate chip cookies, add like a tablespoon of non-fat milk powder, and it will make your chocolate chip cookies taste like the best chocolate chip cookie recipe you cannot get your hands on.
This is good. I thought you were going to say salt. Milk powder's better. Anything on that note, what do you have coming up in terms of new...
What else are we working on? New stores, third cookbook, which is going to be called Cakewalk. So exciting. We actually start shooting it next week. And it's going to be everything from like microwave cakes to crock pot cakes. And we are like terrified about what we're going to do with all of the cake that we put together for these shoots. So we have this really fun plan of going to City Hall one day a week after we're done shooting to give all of the like newlyweds and couples cakes. Like making someone's day, surprising someone with cake. Can you imagine?
I love that idea.
Which I love that. I mean, the spirit of like giving back as well for us is like making someone's day, surprising someone with cake.
Christina, so good to see you. It's great to see you.
I always love spending time with you.
Christina Tosi's third book, Cakewalk, will be published next year. The 11th Milk Bar store opens this month in New York City's West Village. Another thing I often desire, after sleep and dessert, and sometimes even more than those, is wine. But not as much as the people on this next segment do. Jay McInerney talks with Bianca Bosker, author of the new book Cork Dork, and one of her subjects, the extraordinary sommelier Paul Grieco, about the best wines for romance and for these turbulent times. Don't go away.
Hi, I'm Jay McInerney, and I am here at Terroir, a wine bar in Tribeca owned by Paul Grieco, one of the most important figures in the New York wine world. And I'm also here with Bianca Bosker, who is the author of a book coming out next month called Cork Dork. Bianca was kind of a tech dork. She was a tech reporter, editor. When she walked sideways into the world of wine by watching best sommelier in the world competitions on YouTube and wondered, you know, what was up with this crazy wine world and whether there was anything to it. Hello, Paul.
Hello, Jay.
Hello, Bianca.
Hi, Jay.
Hi. But Bianca, let's start with you. And could you expand on my description of your seduction into the world
of
wine.
Yeah, totally. It was actually fairly appropriate.
You're a techie, right?
Yeah, that was my background. At the time, I spent really all day, every day at screens, writing about things that happened at screens. And I have to say, I'd heard about this world of competitive sommeliers, and my first reaction was, bullshit. what? I mean, you open a bottle of wine, you pour it in a glass, you're done. I don't see what you could possibly analyze. And yet here was this high-stakes competition I can only describe as the Westminster dog show with booze. And it was enthralling to me. And I was fascinated first by the obsession, right, the level of care and sacrifice that went into this, you know, that people, you know, really didn't see wine as a job but as a way of life. And flavor was this thing that belonged in the same aesthetic plane as, you know, beauty and art or poetry. And there was also the blind tasting element, and that's what really shook me to the core, which is these people could stick their nose into a glass of wine and tell you stories, histories, you know, where it came from, how, where it was made. I've been covering tech for a very long time, and it made me realize how sterile this world of screens was, and it made me very curious to figure out what the hell was I missing. You know, life is short. Here, most of us tend to ignore these two senses of taste and smell, and it really, for me, was a window into there's so much more I could be experiencing, but I don't know how, I don't know what would happen if it did, and so that, for me, was ultimately what made me quit my job.
Paul is one of the major characters, I guess, in your book. Paul, when did you first start your...
The first terroir opened in 2008 in the East Village. Yeah. And before that, it was Hearth Restaurant. And before that, it was Gramercy Tavern.
Well, the first time I encountered one of your wine lists was at Hearth. And Paul's wine lists are extraordinary documents.
They're works of art.
With all due respect to all the intellectual, all the stuff we're trying to do, other than that, a smile on your face, better damn result with every glass of grape juice.
I'm glad you emphasize that. Sometimes, you know, before I went into wine writing a little bit myself, one of the things that used to upset me was that it was hard to judge from reading wine criticism, wine journalism, that wine, number one, was fun, and number two, had alcohol in it, number three, therefore giving you a buzz, you know? And it's important to go back to the fun. But to go back to the aha moment, once you had undertaken this mission to find out if this was bullshit or if there was really something to it, what was your first aha moment in terms of saying, hey, I think I get this? And I have to say, you came an awfully long way. I mean, I was amazed how much you knew by the end of the book.
Wine snob.
I've been at it on and off for 30 years, but you just dove in head first.
I'd heard about this sort of mystical group of aspiring master sommeliers who met at 11 Madison Park at 9:30 or 10 a.m. every week.
That's when your blind taste buds are best.
It's when you taste buds. Yeah, it's when you're fresh. It's before you've eaten, so you've got these animal instincts. You can smell better. And I basically begged and pleaded and pestered until I got in there. It's the hardest club in New York to get into. And for a very long time, you know, I had no idea what was going on. But I remember, for me, the revelation really came one morning where I stuck my nose into a glass, and it was a cold, bitter, freezing morning in New York. And this white wine, in one sniff, just took me to the summertime, you know, driving down the highway, listening to Stevie Wonder, going to the beach, you know, the roses in bloom. Hmm. It was this visceral reaction that was just...
I think I know what it is. Go ahead.
But you can guess.
Was it a chondria?
Very close.
Viognier?
Yeah.
Viognier.
Well, it was a white Rhone blend. But yeah, you got it. There you go. It's happened to you.
I was thinking of this because partly because I love Chondrio, also because I know Paul's wine list, and I was here about a month ago, and Paul has a lovely little essay on his list about Chondrio. It's one of my default wines for Valentine's. I love that it has a floral quality that it's very aromatic. It's very fleshy in texture. For some reason, I find Chondrio to be a wine of romance, and I'm always pleased to see it on a list. Okay, I've just formed a wine club. Three geeks who are here to recommend a wine for the month of February. Paul, do you want to start?
Of course, but before that, I want to know what the dress code is for our wine club. I hope it's...
I think you're dressed perfectly, Paul. So what is the grape of February 2007?
Oh, Chenin Blanc, definitely. With the opening of, you know, Rouge Tomat, and like Pascaline has obviously made her own mark in a way in the wine world. I think that it's like a new band, right? It's the thing that no one was talking about, and all of a sudden everyone gets to talk about. And it also, you know, is the sort of, sometimes it's sweet, and then...
It's a chameleon.
Yeah,
a chameleon.
Now, but it's, you know, kind of cool in the way that sometimes it's sweet, and it's not cool to say that you like a sweet wine, but I don't know.
Have you got a Valentine's Day wine?
I don't even know how to define a Valentine's Day wine. Something that's going to bring a smile to my loved one's face, to my face. It's going to be Riesling, of course. But in terms of a sensual aromatic or a mouthfeel, no. Are we supposed to look for a beverage that is sort of like sex in your mouth? I don't even know where to go with this. So can I turn it back to you? How would you define?
Well, I think, you know, you say everybody, you know, everybody ends up at Riesling, but I think everybody also ends up at Burgundy. For me, I just find Burgundy to be the most romantic wine, and I think it's where the mind and the heart eventually go. But Burgundy is not reliable. It's not predictable like Bordeaux is.
But in that sense, it's a wonderful metaphor for love, right? It's unpredictable. It slaps you in the face. Sometimes it really charms you, and you've got to spend a lot on it.
Yes,
I would make a vote, if I may, on the first night, I just moved into the apartment with the guy that ended up becoming my husband, and we're sitting among all these cardboard boxes of shit, and he pulled out a bottle of Chateau d'Yquem. And to me, that nice. Wine is the closest.
Marry that guy.
Yeah, yeah. Marry that. It was a winner.
Yeah,
and
in your book, he does not come across as a wine connoisseur, yeah. but clearly he has very good instinct.
Yeah, he nailed it. But to me, that wine is, to me, Sauternes is really the closest thing to an orgasm in a bottle. I mean, it is, it warms you from the inside. A good Sauternes, I mean, it has to be something that is, it is sweet, is acidic, sort of like a great Riesling.
If we can go back 100 and somewhat years to the bistros of Paris, we would begin with oysters. And what did you drink with oysters? Sauternes. Wines of that ilk are truly things that can take you from the beginning to the end of the meal. And if that day is all about luxurious, sensual foodstuffs, you need a wine with sweetness to take you through the meal. And why people are so afraid of sweetness, I guess there's that line that we all talk dry and we drink sweet. But we talk dry and people are scared shitless of sweet, at least in their alcoholic beverages, especially wine. And I don't know what we can do to get over that hump.
Well, yeah, because, you know, it really narrows your the range of appreciation when you consider how many of the world's really great wines are somewhat sweet to very sweet. You know, there's a big bandwidth there from sort of off dry to all the way sweet. And everybody wants to limit themselves to the dry and drier band. I think they're missing out.
So my contribution to the wine club will be Chateau Mussar from Lebanon. And if we're thinking about the complexities of relationships, I'd want something like that in the wine. And Mussar is complex in that every glass that you encounter, every sip that you enjoy is going to be completely different. You're going to be wondering, is it good? Is it bad? Am I supposed to feel this way? And the journey that you're going to go on is going to be extraordinary, and it will be made better because you're going to do it with someone by your side.
I want to raise a glass to that. It's delicious. I mean, on kind of a political note, first of all, February will be our new president's first month in office. So I think it'd be appropriate to start with a female winemaker, Arianna Occhipinti.
Mm-hmm.
Who,
yes,
I hope
Sicily.
I'm pronouncing it correctly. Because it comes from Sicily, which is this hot, bubbling, just volcanic kind of place on Earth, that we need something hot for this month that is all about love. So whether you've just had a heartbreak or whether you're falling in love, I think we could all use a little more warmth.
Well, I've already said that I'm a Burgundy lover. If you can't find one of my favorites, for instance, Freddie Mounier's Chambeau Musigny Les Amoureux, which means the lovers, of course, which is the ultimate Valentine's Day wine. You should start a little lower down the chain, perhaps with the wines of Beaujolais. I know that's a dirty word in many people's vocabulary, but in fact, Beaujolais is undergoing something of a renaissance, and there are some really great, passionate, conscientious makers who are reviving this this region that was nearly ruined in the 80s and 90s. I'm not necessarily speaking of Beaujolais per se, but there are the crews of Beaujolais, Moulin Avant, Fleury, Bruy, Morgon, these specific appellations within Beaujolais, the 2014 and now especially the 2015 vintage. It's a great kind of gateway to the pleasures of Burgundy. Different grape, Gamay, not Pinot Noir, but I recommend that you might start there. It's an accessible entry to the Burgundy experience. Bianca, Paul, thanks so much for being here. Paul, thanks for letting me hang out in Terroir.
Jay, a big pleasure to welcome you to our humble little joint, and cheers.
Bianca, congratulations on your publication.
I think this is a really good start to the wine club.
Go on, go, let's do this, go on. I'm Isaac Mizrahi, and this is my Madeline moment. Every time I eat an apricot, I think of a little dried apricot. I think of my grandmother. She lived with my aunt, and it was this kind of like a two-family house in Brooklyn where there's people living upstairs and others living downstairs, and they had the downstairs. And she had a room in the downstairs, and it was this kind of very middle-class kind of brick building with a backyard and a small front lawn. And it was across, it was like on a boulevard called Ocean Parkway, and across the street was this wonderful, like across the parkway, which was not easy to get across, was this little park that I really loved going to. And she used to take us to that little park. I was like 6 or 7 years old. My grandmother used to give me apricots, and she used to say, don't tell anyone I'm giving you, because, you know, I had my sisters and cousins and everything. You're my favorite. Here's some apricots. Do not tell anyone. But of course, she did the same thing with my sisters and all my cousins. She would take us all aside, say, you're my favorite, don't tell anyone I'm giving you these. That's when I started doing the junk. That's when I gave in to, like, yeah, I'm just kidding. Yeah, she ruined me. Yeah.
Sweet lotus blossom, please do.
That's all for this month on Print Street. Next month, we'll be talking about cleanup with Melissa and Jasmine Hemsley and the makers of the documentary Plastic Oceans. Plus, we're launching our new Print Street spinoff with a live interview at Dean & DeLuca's flagship store in Soho. Bill Buford talks with Martha Stewart on March 2nd. I'll be there. I hope you will, too. Check out our website, livefromprintstreet.com, for more details.
If I was a food, I would pick a watermelon, because a watermelon is very tasty and it's got lots of black seeds. When I like black, it's my favorite color, and it grows in like the wild and the wilderness.
Print Street is executive produced by Charles Finch and produced by Elizabeth Robinson. The executive in charge of production is Julian Plante. Our segment producers are Rob Corso and Rose Reed. Special thanks to Matilda Holst, Megan Horgan, and Tom Camuso.
I would pick sushi because I feel natural sometimes, and also that I'm really fun at some parts of like learning Korean and doing Taekwondo, so I feel like it represents that country as a food.
And I'm your host, Howie Kahn. Follow us on Instagram and Twitter at prince_street_. See you next time.
Prince Street is brought to you by Dean & DeLuca, purveyors of the finest food since 1977. With over 40 stores around the world, Dean & DeLuca curates the best ingredients for life.